So what I'm doing here now is the next ply that we're going to do. It's going to be a spiral ply like we've just done, except what we're going to do now is overply it and then cable it. So this will essentially give you a four ply yarn. Now I'll show you what I'm doing here. I'm actually putting a lot of extra twist into this. See how that's going to bunch up? But the reason for that is because we're going to be plying it on itself, and this is what I want it to look like when it's done. So it has lots and lots of lovely texture. It's bulky, but it's not hard and solid like rope, because we've taken out quite a lot of twist. But the key is that I need to get enough twist in there that it will twist back round on itself, and that you know when it's done it right, because it kind of, all these little bits lock in and it ends up looking a little bit sort of bead like it's really satisfying. I love spinning cables. You make little cute little jigsaw puzzle pieces that all fit in together somehow. But this is something I do, how I've taken this off the wheel now. I do this frequently because it's very easy while you're spinning to slip back into plying for balance, and suddenly you don't have enough twist in your yarn and it won't ply back on itself in such a satisfying way. So I've got quite a lot of twist there. I'll just check that again. That's going to work. Plenty of twist. I don't want to make it into a rope, so I'm only going to put in just as much as it needs, but no more, to get that nice ply onto itself. If I put too much twist in here, if I hang on to it too much for too long, it is going to turn hard and rope-like, and that's not what we're aiming for with this bulky spinning. But I'm just letting it ply. This is literally just the same as a spiral ply. See the angle that I'm holding this on? I'm treadling quite fast because I want to increase the twist. So I want to make sure there's enough going in there. See how this is? You can really see the difference between this and the normal spiral ply. Let's see if I can get that focusing for you. This is really tight in comparison to the normal spiral ply. Normally with a spiral ply, remember, you can see the thread in the middle, but with this we can't. But if I try testing this again, look, that's just popped back and joined up the little bits to make the bead-like look to it. I love that effect. You can do this with two ply yarns. So you ply it on itself, over twist it, and then ply those two plies together in the same way that we're going to do this. But I didn't want to add that much bulk to it. This is going to make a nice, you see the thickness of that yarn. That is a pretty bulky yarn. If I'd done four plies of this single, then it's going to be even bigger than that Navajo ply that we did as well, which was three ply. And it was just a bit too bulky for what I wanted. So that's why I'm using it with a thread ply. Also, I do really like the texture that this gives me. It really shows the contrast between the thin thread and the thick single, and I think that makes a really nice texture and adds interest in that contrast that it provides. If you do a four ply cable with four thick singles, it will be less extreme in the texture, more extreme in the thickness. So I'm going to finish plying this, and then once I have some on two bobbins, I'm going to show you how I ply those together. And the aim with this is for balance. So I'm onto my second bobbin now. And I sort of just add in there, one of the ways I am increasing the twist in this yarn, apart from treadling faster, is I'm also holding on to this thread for longer. I've got a tighter grip on it, and I'm not letting it run out of my hands as quickly as I was when I was spiral plying. I'm just holding on to it just that little bit longer and forcing the twist into it. So that is another way you can be sure of adding enough twist. Hold on to the thread longer, gives it more time for that twist to build up before it gets onto the bobbin. See, there's lots of extra twist built up in there, so I know it's going to ply for me. Kind of, it's a hard thing to do. It kind of goes against everything we've ever learnt about plying, adding in too much twist on a ply. So it's just something you've got to stay conscious of. This is not a yarn that I spin while I'm binge watching something on Netflix. This is a yarn I spin when I'm watching what I'm doing, because I have to remember to keep checking regularly to make sure that I haven't slipped back into old good habits of plying for balance. Right, I am plying my two overspun plied yarns together and getting this really neat texture and a super bulky yarn, but it's got a nice weight to it. It's not overly heavy, it doesn't feel like rope, it's nice and soft, because we've just taken out enough twist to do that. And what I'm doing is I'm not spinning it, not treadling nearly as fast as I was for plying, because I'm not trying to over spin this one. I'm looking for balance now, and you can see if I just let it go, it almost does it itself. It just kind of locks into place, and you can see when it's balanced, because if you actually look down here, you're going to see a straight line. Those threads, you can just see them in the middle there. The threads that we use to thread ply are just running directly down the center of this yarn, and these little puffs are our coils that have opened up and that are sticking out now. And it's so satisfying to spin this and see this all just lock into place. I just love it. It's quite addictive, I'm warning you. You've been told. I've started doing this and I just keep finding so many variations to this. Have you thought things like, if one of these singles was done with a lock spun yarn, what would that look like when it's cabled? Or if I used core spun instead of a standard single, what would that look like? Or if I use three thick and one thin, how would that be? There's so many variations. The key things to remember are over twist your two ply and keep checking it frequently to make sure you've got the right amount. And don't forget, when you're plying, I'm plying now in the Z direction, the same direction I spun my singles in, because every time I put this back on the wheel, I go in the opposite direction. So I spun my singles Z, I plied them S, and now I'm plying them again Z. So it's really important that you do it the right direction, otherwise it turns into a tangled mess. And I know this because I've done it myself. Definite experience speaking there. So this will give you a really bulky yarn with some nice texture. This is from my smooth singles. Like I said, if you want to play around with different textures, you can create some lock spun singles to try this with. The main control area you need here is, first of all, you need to have your bulky singles to start with, which we've already covered in the earlier videos. And then you need to be, in control of your twist. Know how much you're putting in and then how much you're taking out. Just about at the end of this. Can you hear? I live by a park and it's Sunday today and everybody's out there playing. It's kind of nice. I find it quite restful. Okay, we're just about at the end of that one. So I'm pretty excited about this yarn. I really love the way it comes out. Now I can also, you can see in here, you still get to see the thread that I've thread plied with, more so after it's been plied again. Remember with that coil, with the over twisted coil, you couldn't really see it, but look how it comes back again when you open up that coil, when you twist it in the opposite direction. And here I can see it's balanced, because here you can see the thread running in a straight line right down the center. Also, all your fibers are running that way. What I'm probably going to do with this one is dye it after I've spun it, and I love to do that because I love, for me, the most exciting thing with color is where I put two colors and they meet. And when you have a yarn and you dye it after it's spun, especially the bulky yarns, because it gives you a beautiful color graduation if you're doing multiple color dyes. And when you're spinning a colored prep bulky, you tend to get more of the striping and more contrast in the colors. So that's one of the reasons I like to spin my bulky yarns undyed and then dye them afterwards, because I have control again over where the colors are placed, and you really get quite a noticeable difference when you do it that way.
fall.